Tonight's message is entitled Black Lives Matter. That's what we're talking about tonight. Black Lives Matter in the light of apologetics. What do we do for those who are part of the sect of the Nazarene, who have the way persuasion, who have grown up in Christianity? What do we do with the inherent violence and intrinsic racism that has been a part of white male Christianity? What do we do about the flaws, hamartias, and the fatal mistakes that Christians have made in church history? What do we do about racism? Well, I'm actually going to talk to you tonight about how the Bible is one of the most, if not the most, radically anti-racist text written in the ancient world when you compare it to and juxtapose it against other religious literature. It is passionately, it is zealously, it is ardently anti-racist. And that's what's really fascinating. So when you see it, what I'm going to argue for is, as we're doing this apologetic study, we're going to study in Galatians tonight. When you look at church history and you say, well, what do I do with all these Christians who are racist in the past? Their racism was not because of Jesus' teachings or because of Paul's teachings. Their racism was in spite of the New Testament teachings. In fact, the entire Old Testament hinges on this huge story called Exodus, where slaves are set free from their masters. The Israelites being set free from their bondage under the Egyptians because of this racism that was going on back then. So I want to talk to you about how the faith, how Christianity, and again, I'm not talking about all the baggage that comes with Christendom of religiosity and churchianity. I'm talking about Jesus' teachings and his legacy. What do we do with the racism that is part of Christianity, even though it is not part of Jesus or Paul's teachings in the New Testament? It's not a biblical concept as we understand it today. So first, I want to talk about some racism in church history. And we got to own up to this. James K. Polk was an American president who was very, very good at expanding America. He's the one who annexed places like California. He gave us California. We here in Oregon owe a lot of thanks to James K. Polk. That's why we're part of America and have been included in these United States, is because of James K. Polk. Now, Polk was very ambitious. I love that he's ambitious. He did believe in manifest destiny, that we should expand our territory, but he also was devoutly Christian. Now, I'm not just talking about a guy who professes his faith. Here's a guy who like spends time in scripture. James K. Polk was devoutly religious and he wanted to add California to the United States. So how does he get it? He steals it from the Mexicans. And I know that's controversial, but it's what happened. And he started effectively and essentially the Mexican-American War. So what do we do about the fact that we stole California from Mexicans? What do we do about the fact that there has been inherent racism against Hispanics? What do we do about that? Then let's go over to black people, Black Lives Matter. What do you do with a majority Christian nation that accepts slavery and insinuates that slaves are 3/5 of a person as written by the Constitution of the United States? What do we do about that? What do we do about Indians? How, of course, you know, the colonialization of America and the killing of Indians, not just the killing of Indians, but it's murdering them essentially and then giving them casinos as reparations. Like, that's not going to do the job. Manifest destiny. What do you do about Martin Van Buren, Andrew Jackson, who were responsible for the Trail of Tears, extraditing Indians from their lands, and on the Trail of Tears, they were perishing in the wilderness. What do we do about Millard Fillmore when he was arresting and making sure that the police of his day, back in the day in the 19th century, in the 1800s, was arresting, his force was arresting, he was like obsessed with arresting escaped slaves. And those slaves that escaped from the north, from the south and tried to get to the north, he would arrest them and bring them back to their homes to judge them. What do we do about this? So tonight I'm actually gonna broaden it a little bit. It's not just about Black Lives Matter. I also want to include Indian Lives Matter, Jewish Lives Matter, and Hispanic Lives Matter. You say, well, Ben, why don't you say white lives matter? Don't all lives matter? Yes, all lives matter. But I want to talk about why we need to focus on certain ethnicities if we're taking the biblical narrative into account in this passage before us. And we're I want to say this one more thing. Why did so much, I just read this today. Again, a lot of this research is coming from Rebecca McLaughlin, this wonderful Cambridge doctor who has done amazing research into apologetics. And I kind of want to portray some of this information to you because we need apologetics for a new generation to talk about these hot button issues that, again, we don't really want to address. But what do we do about the fact that so many German pastors supported Adolf Hitler? Not everybody was Dietrich Bonhoeffer and they're willing a few days before the Allies rescue them from concentration camps. He's a German pastor who gets executed for his faith, or those two siblings who got beheaded for their faith. What do we do for people the fact that so many German pastors were not like Bonhoeffer and they actually supported Adolf Hitler, German pastors supporting Adolf Hitler? What do we do about that? How do you accept majority Christian America embracing slavery? We can't wink our eye at this. So before I get into our text, I want to say the incredible anti-racist movement that is known as Christianity, I do want to say that I'm well aware of our flaws. But I also want to say that racism is not because of Christian teaching, it's in spite of Christian teaching, and it actually proves this Christian teaching that all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Even when you look at the Crusades, the Christians taking territory from the Muslims, Jerusalem, it's way more complicated than just that. There was also Muslim provocation, and there was horrible barbaric Christian acts. Both sides take some blame. But what I am saying is this, I do believe that Christianity is the most anti-racist movement of history, but I also want to acknowledge and fess up to the fact that there have been incredible faults and flaws too, but I want to talk about how much progress we've made. We still have a ways to go. So let's take a look at Galatians 3:28, because I am a white male, so I just want to talk to you about what a Jewish guy had to say about racism, because as you know, Jews suffered racism at the hands of the Babylonians, the Persians, the Medes, the Chaldees, the Assyrians, the Egyptians, the Romans, the Greeks, the Germans, like we're well aware, even some of the Protestant Lutheran Christians. So I want to talk about what does Paul say as a Jewish guy who knows what it's like to experience racism, to be on the bitter end of that deal. Galatians 3:28, here's what Paul the Apostle teaches. There is neither Jew nor Greek. Okay, you've heard this. If you're in your Bible, again, turn to Galatians 3:28. You've heard this before. You're like, oh yeah, that's cool. He said the same thing in Colossians that he says in Galatians. There's neither Jew nor Greek, Scythian nor barbarian, slave nor free. There's neither Hebrew nor Greek. Like, we've heard this before. Do you know what a big deal this was that Paul would say that? That he would say, actually, there really is no difference between us because of the color of our skin, because of the ethnicity or nationality that we belong to. This is, dare I say, culturally revolutionary. It's like a firebrand. He says, there is neither Jew nor Greek. Then he goes on to say, there is neither slave nor free. He says, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. He says, no longer is race, no longer is gender, no longer is socioeconomic position a wall or barrier that tears us down. Ephesians 2, the middle wall of separation in the temple that separated Gentiles from Hebrews has been torn apart by Jesus' death and ultimately through Titus, the general who would become an emperor when he wiped out the temple in AD 70, as Jesus predicted would happen. So what I want to tell you is this. Paul's saying that middle wall of separation that divides Jews from Greeks, slaves from free, males from female, it's all Scythians from barbarians, Greeks from Hebrews, that has been extirpated, eradicated, and wiped out. That's what Paul's telling us. Big stuff. In fact, you even see echoes of this. This is kind of an echo chamber for the Old Testament. In Exodus chapter 30, verse 12 through 16, when those who were 20 years and older were to be under a census that was taken, when a census was taken, what they would have to do by consensus is they would all have to pay half a shekel if you were 20 years and older. And it specifically says, whether you are a master or a servant, you're still having to pay half a shekel. Why? Because he's saying Moses is saying, you're all worth half a shekel. So whether you're a slave or free, no matter who you are, if you're 20 and up, you're all of the same worth. Your value for the census that you're to bring as an offering for the Lord is half a shekel. You're all the same value, same playing field. You're all worth half a shekel when it comes to this census and an offering that you're going to bring to the Lord if you're 20 years and up. Amazing. Isn't that crazy? That all the way in Exodus chapter 30, verse 12 through 16, this is happening, that the servant paid the half shekel as well as the master. You're all worth the same, is what he was saying. So this is an objective fact. This is not a subjective opinion. The New Testament, and I'm very passionate about this, is one of the most anti-racist texts ever written. I was watching this interview by a Ku Klux Klan wizard. Literally, they're called wizards. And the fact that they would adopt Christianity as their slogan, or the fact that Adolf Hitler would take the Lord's Prayer and insert his name, the Führer. He would actually replace Jesus with his own life. And he said Jesus was blonde-haired and blue-eyed. I'm sorry, Adolf, despite what your propositions are in Mein Kampf, Jesus was Jewish, so he wasn't blonde-haired. He just wasn't, no matter what the movies portray him as. He was Jewish. And the anti-Semitism that has been propagated by somebody like Adolf Hitler and the Ku Klux Klan history, and just seeing the subtle racism where the black community are saying, African Americans are saying, listen, Black Lives Matter too. We need to listen. We need to listen. Because the truth of the matter is, the very heart of the New Testament is that it is the most anti-racist text, one of the most emphatically anti-racist texts ever written. Juxtapose it and compare it with literature of its time. Compare it with other religious texts. And this is very, very important to know. So let me get more to the heart though. Maybe you're watching this and you are Hispanic, you are African, Jewish. I'm actually, I think like an eighth Jewish or something, but I mean like, let's say you're at a place, an Indian, where you or your ancestors, your parents, your grandparents, let's say you're at a place where you've really suffered racism, because the world is shrinking now. Like, even though I live here in Oregon, the fact is, like Hope Generation, we reach across tribes and tongues. 180 countries is what we're actually reaching. And in the world of the internet now, we really have to hit this on the head. I look at my beautiful, gorgeous nieces, Charlotte and Tallulah. I accidentally called them nephews, my nephews, because sometimes my brain gets confused when I have so much information in here. But I guess there's neither male nor female, so there you go. No, I'm joking. But my beautiful nieces adopted, they're the most beautiful black girls. They're just the most beautiful girl. You look at these precious souls. And this is something that, for me, I look at my beautiful family and I look at black friends that I have, or Hispanic or Indian or whatever. We look around at people we're connected with. The world is shrinking now. You can't just stay in your own little bubble very easily. We're all more interconnected than we think. And we really have to address some of this stuff for a new generation. Like, we really do. And if you've suffered racism, let's just say you have, let me really talk to you from my heart. I know that I, as a white male, can't relate to you. But there is a great high priest who can be touched by your infirmities. There was a Jew who suffered the anti-Semitism of being crucified as an innocent man by the state, carrying a recycled timber, 100 pounds of recycled timber with other people's blood and sweat and tears on there, people that had died before him. He takes this recycled cross, carries it up a tree and dies. He knows what it's like to suffer injustice, the ultimate injustice, when this Jew suffered at the hands of the Romans. And what I want to tell you is this. Jesus can sympathize with you in the scriptural narrative. I was just listening to this today. Again, Rebecca McLaughlin had a great point here as I'm doing this apologetic study, how it says Jesus wept. And there's a lot of explanations for why he wept. And I really liked what she suggested, that Jesus wept. He's the resurrection and the life. He calls Lazarus forth. Why would he weep when he knows, like he can just call him back from the dead? Well, one suggestion is this. Because Mary and Martha were distressed, they were weeping. And if they're weeping, he's gonna weep. He will weep with those who weep, as Paul said we're supposed to do. He's moved with compassion. He doesn't just say, oh, I feel bad for you, dude. He's like moved with compassion as he sees sheep without a shepherd when he looks at the wandering masses and multitudes. And so what I wanna say is, what if Jesus wept? The shortest verse in English, the shortest verse in Greek is actually rejoice always, but be that as it may. When it says Jesus wept, could it be because he was weeping because he saw how much Mary and Martha were hurt? Could it be that he images a God who says, when you weep, I weep too? Hey, I know it's all gonna work out. I know Lazarus is gonna rise again. I know everything's gonna be fine. But you're hurting, and I see that. And could it be that Jesus shows us a God who weeps when we weep? And if you've wept, if you've suffered injustice, can I tell you that you have someone who can relate to you, a Jew from Nazareth who images a God who loves you? And what I want to say is this, and this is where it gets pretty cool. Christianity has shown that it's not just one of the most emphatically anti-racist texts ever written. Through its literature, it's also put wheels on this. Despite all of Christianity's flaws in this area, listen to what happened. Christians began to take the teachings of Jesus so much to heart that in the fourth century, they gathered together the marginalized, specifically those who were poor and sick, and they invented something in the fourth century. That invention was called hospitals. In the fourth century, it was Christians who, through empathy, sympathy, you weep, I weep, compassion, moved with compassion, what do? They invent hospitals. Hospitals were invented in the fourth century by Christians. You look at Jesus, who looks around, and he says, blessed are the poor. Now, this is what I would say. A lot of people say, hey, it's not Black Lives Matter, it's all lives matter. The problem that I have with that is simply this. Jesus could have said, blessed are all people, but he didn't. He said, blessed are the poor. What was he doing? He was targeting a marginalized group that had known oppression. And sometimes I think we need to hear the cry of the needy. In fact, the Bible just talks about that a lot. The cry of the oppressed and say, let me listen to you. Not just, oh, hey, everybody, blessed is everybody. I mean, by saying everybody, you're saying nothing. You're like a prophet of nothingness. But if you're Jesus and you see the poor, you say, you know what? I'm going to specifically bless them. I think we can say all lives matter, but we need to look at the history of what has happened with Africans, especially in America and in church history with Hispanics and Indians and Jews, and we, et cetera. And we look at them and we say, you do matter. What can we do to show you that race has been eradicated, that we have different color of our skin, but the same value to our soul. We're all the half shekel. We're all worth the same. So you are somebody who has imputed to you divine worth and love and creativity and the image of God on you. So what can I do to break down the middle wall of separation and show that there's neither Greek nor Jew? Just as Paul said here. A lot of other people would say, hey, well, you know what, dude? I'm just colorblind. Okay? Well, that's a problem too. What if you said, I'm just poverty blind? Like if people are poor, like they've been oppressed, but I'm blind to that. You'd say, no, hopefully we'll hear the cry of the oppressed. So when African Americans, for example, are saying, listen, we matter. What I'm saying is, shouldn't we hear? Shouldn't we listen? And shouldn't we seek to unify people by hearing the cries of the oppressed? Now, what does the Bible say about this? Let's go even further. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Revelation. Let's go over to the very end so we can see sort of the climactic revelation of John. It's not only in the lifestyle of Jesus, he weeps when others weep. It's not just in the teaching and writing of Paul. It's also in the revelation of John. And then we'll come back to Jesus at the core of this. But the scene here is of a placid sea, a rainbow, a throne, a lamb next to the throne. It's a beautiful scene of God ruling and reigning. In Revelation 7:9, the last book of the Bible paints a picture of the end of time when, read this, Revelation 7:9, a great multitude that no one could number from where? Every nation. From where? All tribes and peoples and languages are worshiping before the throne. And what do they have in their hands? Palm branches. So we see this picture of all the nations, all the tribes, all the tongues, speaking different languages everywhere. They're all coming together. There's a rainbow, there's a sea, there's a throne, there's a lamb. Everybody's one. And their oneness is found in him. Where do we find our unity? Look at what Paul says in Galatians, our text earlier. What did he say? There is neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, Scythian nor barbarian, slave nor free. Where? We are all one. Where? In Christ. So this Christ dimension that unites us is greater than any differences that might otherwise divide us. And so John sees this great picture of everybody being unified. Isn't that a beautiful picture? Having palm branches in their hands from every tribe, tongue, nation, all over the world, the four corners of the earth. Just like the garment of Jesus was torn into four pieces because there was four corners of the world so that people who are naked from all corners of the world can be clothed in his righteousness. But watch this. Why do they have palms in their hands? In token of victory over spiritual enemies. What do you mean? This was not only a sign of military or kingly victory, if you would. This was hinted at by those poems that were engraved in the temple of both Ezekiel. Remember, Ezekiel had his vision of the new temple, and Solomon's temple. Then, of course, you have Herod's temple, and of course, you have Zerubbabel's temple, etc., and the renovated by Herod, Ezra, Nehemiah, etc., Zechariah, that whole scene. But if you look at the temple of Ezekiel, and if you look at the temple of Solomon, they had palms engraved in it. So what are all the tribes and tongues holding in Revelation 7? All the peoples of the world are holding palms. Why? Because Peter said, the Apostle Peter, that we are living stones built together to build a temple for the Lord. So there's stones of all different colors, from all different tribes, from all different kinds, from all different geological regions. We come together as colored stones, living stones, to build a temple for the Lord, just as Ezekiel and Solomon's temple in the Old Testament had palms engraved in the temple. So too, we're going to hold palm branches and we're going to say we're all one because we are a temple made of living stones. How sick is that? Oh, I'm getting excited. I'm getting excited. You guys doing good over there? John? Dylan, you chilling? That rhymed. Alex, I see you in the shadows lurking back there. I see Joe Strobel. It's good to see you, Joe. Let's keep going. So, can I share the good news now? that's where history is going. Racism is annihilated before the throne of God. But let me show you this. This is where the good news comes in. Today, this is a fact. This is not subjective opinion. This is objective research. This is fact, studious facts. Today, Christianity is the most evenly distributed belief system in the world in terms of race and culture. So the revelation of John came true. It's coming true, I should say. Today, Christianity is the most evenly distributed belief system in the world in terms of race and culture, more so than any other by a long chalk, as they say in Britain, or by a long shot, as we say in America. And that's only increasing. So when we're talking about apologetics and giving a defense for the faith and a reason for the hope that's within us, when people come against Christianity and they say, hey, listen, there's a lot of racism in the past, we need to say, yes, there is, but you have to look at what also is happening in the forward march of the progress of the kingdom of God being advanced into our generation. So now Christianity is seeing all tribes and tongues being more evenly distributed. Christianity is among all races and cultures than any other by a long shot, any other belief system, and that's only increasing. So you have two dreams. That'd be a good title, either Indian Lives Matter or Two Dreams, but I'm going to stick with Black Lives Matter, keep it simple. You had the dream of John Lennon. John Lennon with the song Imagine. And he sung, I imagine a world where there is no country, no possession, nothing to kill for, nothing to die for, no religion. He said, that was the land he imagined, where we're all united in a world system where there's no religion, there's nothing worth dying for, no country, no possessions, nothing worth killing for. And so essentially it's sort of like an atheistic communist dream, if you would. 8 years earlier, another prophetic voice, John Lennon had a prophetic voice to his generation. They looked at him as a prophet. But let's go 8 years earlier to the one Billy Graham called a prophet in America. Martin Luther King Jr., he also had a dream. John Lennon said, I dream of a world without religion. But Martin Luther King Jr. said, I have a dream that little black boys and little white girls, or little black boys and little black girls, little white boys and little white girls will all hold hands and play together. And then he quoted the Old Testament. He said, the valleys will be raised up to the mountains and the hills will be brought low and raised to the ground, quoting Isaiah. And he was a passionate Baptist minister. The civil rights movement that JFK wanted to see passed through Congress and that LBJ really put wheels on, friends, this was begun by a Baptist, this was spearheaded by a passionate Baptist minister named Martin Luther King Jr., a Christian Baptist. So I don't know about you, but I like King's dream a little better than John Lennon's dream. And I'll tell you why in a moment. Because atheism or at least secular humanism, is the worldview of white Western men in communist regimes. So a lot of people say, oh, white male privilege. If you're white male aging and you're a Republican and you're on the far right, then you're going to be a Christian. Statistically, it's actually doesn't really work that way. Statistically, atheism, or at least secular humanism, is the worldview of white Western men in communist regimes. So isn't that interesting? You look at the book of Acts, and how did that start? Acts 1, Jesus starts off the book by saying, you Jewish boys are going to start in Jerusalem. We talked about this last week and yesterday. You're going to go to Judea, Samaria, the uttermost ends of the earth. You're to spread the gospel to all races. And yet, what did they do? Seven chapters later, they're still in their comfort zone in Jerusalem. So what happens? Persecution hits, and they then are forced to disperse to the uttermost ends of the earth. And it's in Acts chapter 8 that the gospel comes to Africa. We'll talk about that in just a moment. I'm almost done here, but watch this. Sometimes the struggle tends to get us out of our bubble, and Jesus' vision was that the gospel would not just stay in Jerusalem where they stayed for seven chapters, but that persecution would scatter them and spread them to Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost ends of the earth. That was the vision of Jesus. So a lot of people think Christianity is associated with white male privilege, when did you know that in America and globally, typically the person who tends to be a Christian statistically is a woman of color. So your old Christianity is the religion of white male privilege. Actually, in America, Black Americans are at least 10% more likely to identify themselves as Christians than whites. Isn't that interesting? So let's go back to Jesus. The ethno-religion, so we've been looking at like Acts, we've been looking at John, we've been looking at Jesus, we've been looking at Ezekiel, we've been looking at Solomon, we've been looking at the half shekel of Exodus chapter 20, we've been looking at Paul, but now I want to go back to Jesus. How did he handle ethno-religious, sort of male-dominant, self-centric racism? How did he handle that? Well, Jesus had to deal with racism in his day that the Jews projected onto Samaritans. See, Samaritans were hated by Jewish people. Even John 4 tells us this. John says, Jews don't have any dealings with Samaritans. Like, they'll go out of their way to avoid Samaritans. Samaritans were like mudbloods. They were the half-breed. They were half the enemy blood, the Assyrians, who had conquered the Jewish people, and they were half Hebrew. And so the Jewish people, the pure bloods, hated Samaritans. So not only that, but you weren't allowed to talk to women publicly in the streets, because even though the Bible says, hey, there's no male nor female, to them, if you talk to a woman as a rabbi in a prolonged conversation in the streets, the rabbi said you would in the end inherit Gehenna, so in the end you would go to hell. So what does Jesus do? His longest recorded conversation in public was in John 4 with who? A woman from what race? The Samaritan race. So even though the Jews were racist against Samaritans, what does Jesus do? He goes out of his way to talk to a woman who, watch this, culturally, a Samaritan woman in a Jewish man's mindset had less value than a man's donkey. So typically, a Samaritan woman had less value than a man's donkey. So what does Jesus do? He has his longest conversation with a Samaritan woman, and this is where it gets insane. It says the disciples were amazed that he spoke with a woman. Friends, it doesn't say the disciples were amazed that Jesus rose from the dead. It doesn't say they were amazed that he walked on water. It doesn't say they were amazed that he multiplied a few loaves of fishes to feed 5,000 people, 15 to 20,000 if you count women and children. What does it say? They're amazed that he broke this, chauvinistic, misogynistic, racial barrier when Jesus poured out to a Samaritan woman. It says they were amazed. Because that's what Jesus did. He was tearing down misogynistic race in his day. So I'm almost done, but a lot of people say, you know, Western European cultural missionary colonization is what really spread Christendom around the world. But I would say this, did you know, this is another fact that you're gonna love. Most of the world's Christians today are neither white nor Western. Christianity is in fact getting less white and less Western by the day. So Christianity is actually spreading in its cultural variety. Christianity, this is insane, is the most ethnically, culturally, socioeconomically, and racially diverse belief system in the world. So yes, we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Yes, we are morally, fundamentally flawed. That's why communism doesn't always work. And that's why there's so much violence in communist regimes over the past 100 years. Who knows where Kim Jong-un is? He like disappeared. We don't know where he is. But what I will say is this, Christianity is now beginning to fulfill this vision of all tribes and tongues at the throne of God, united because ethnically, culturally, socioeconomically, and racially, Christianity is the most diverse belief system in the world. This is important for you to know when it comes to apologetics. Because if you think your faith is racist, you're on the wrong path, friends. If you care about diversity, and our generation does, especially my generation, do not dismiss Christianity. When it comes to apologetics, we have to talk about racism. If you care about diversity, do not dismiss Christianity. It is the most diverse, multi-ethnic, and multicultural movement in all of history. That is not an opinion. That is a statistical fact. So, the most typical Christian, both in America and globally, is a woman of color, which undoes the stereotype of the dominance of white male privilege. Now, let's go back to the Black Lives Matter thing. How did Christianity come to black people? How did it come to Africa? How did it come to Ethiopia? Let's talk about this. It's in Acts chapter 8. As persecution is beginning, the church is spreading. Philip, who was a deacon, was directed to a chariot where an Ethiopian eunuch who was serving in the court of Queen Candace, so he was a high up official in the cabinet of Queen Candace, this Ethiopian eunuch, he's sitting there reading a scroll of Isaiah 53, and Philip interprets it for him. He says, actually, this is foreshadowing the life of Jesus. The Ethiopian eunuch says, can I get baptized? And Philip says, sure, why not? Baptizes him. Now, we don't know for sure what happened with that Ethiopian eunuch, but it's very possible that he then, he was a black man. So Philip in Acts 8 was ministering to a black man. Philip, a Jew, ministering to a black man. Actually, pardon me, I don't remember what race Philip was. I can't really remember because there's neither Hebrew nor Greek, so who cares? So he ministers to this black man. Then the gospel spreads to an African, and evidently it goes to Africa because this man was so influential. He was a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all of her treasure. So he's like the treasure secretary, like Mnuchin, who projects a big fourth quarter boom for our economy after the coronavirus. This is powerful stuff. So the gospel comes to Africans, not through white Western colonial missionary work, although that was a part of it. It also came through a guy named Philip a couple millennia ago in the Bible in Acts chapter 8. So Colossians 3, Galatians 3, they all talk about this socioeconomic diversity as a core ethic from the start. I'll close with this. Jesus made loving the poor central to his teaching and ministry. His brother James commanded Christians not to treat rich people better than poor people in their gatherings. If you show partiality, James warned chapter 2, verse 8 through 9, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. If we show favoritism to people of a certain race, if we show favoritism to people of certain socioeconomic position, if we show partiality, James says we're actually committing sin. So let me close with this. It's time for us to blow up the barriers, to find our unity in this Christ dimension, to look forward to this throne, this lamb, this rainbow, this sea where all tribes, tongues, multitudes are waving palm branches, just as Ezekiel and Solomon's temple had the palms engraved on their temple stones, where living stones built together to create a temple for the living God. We need to undo the wrongs from church history. And we need to also realize that we're making incredible progress. It's becoming less white and Western as we speak. And so the goal is that race simply would not matter anymore. That we would get to a place where we go back to the early church. What did they do? What did the early church do? How did the church start? And I close with how the church started. So I close with the start. In Acts 2, it says that the early church started Pentecost when the Spirit fell on the 120 gatherers. Jesus' mom was among them, this Jewish woman. They were gathered up in an upper room, hiding away from the authorities, quarantined, just like we're quarantined and Pentecost is upon us, which isn't that weird how that worked out? Like Pentecost is upon us and like it's the time of Pentecost and we're in quarantine. And during the Pentecost in Acts 2, they were in quarantine. They were hiding behind closed doors because of the authorities. They were scared of just like people are scared of the disease, the coronavirus. Pretty crazy correlation prophetically, if you would, or just poetically. But it says the Spirit came upon them and it says that they began to speak in tongues. Now, Pentecost had people from all tribes and tongues, proselytes to Judaism, coming from all over the world. And this is so cool. It says that they began to speak in tongues. Remember how I talked about a few weeks ago, how Ezekiel saw these visions of spinning wheels. Dude, there's wheels spinning. And Peter saw Jesus glowing and he didn't know what he was saying. He's like, let's build tabernacles for Moses and Elijah. And Peter's on the house of Simon the Tanner, the roof, and he sees like a vision of a blanket falling from heaven with all these creeping critters. And it says he was in a trance. The word for trance in Greek is ecstasis, from which we get our word ecstasy. So it's saying he was in an altered state of mind and he didn't even have to take drugs to get there because there ain't no high like the Most High. We talked all about that last week. But they also now think Peter's drunk. Like, poor Peter. The guy's always in an altered state of mind. It's like he doesn't know what he's saying. Hey, Jesus is glowing. Let's build temples for Moses and Elijah. Oh, I see he's in a trance, ecstasis. He's in a state of ecstasy, not from drugs, but from the Most High. He sees like a blanket with creeping critters. And don't call the Gentiles unclean, even though you call these animals unclean. Now don't call unclean what God has called clean. And that was actually an anti-racist message. I just thought of that just now, which is pretty cool. And so Peter began to spread the message to people who weren't Jewish. He said, you don't have to become a Jew to be saved. It's not about race. Now Peter is accused of being drunk. Peter says, hey, nobody gets drunk at this time of the day. And he speaks out to the nations that are gathered there at the day of Pentecost, there in the upper room when the Spirit falls, the tongues of fire are on their heads. And it says that they began to speak in tongues, specifically that the others could understand. I remember years ago, I read this in J. Vernon McGee, actually, funny enough. And he talked about how they were actually speaking tongues that the nations could understand. And even Acts 2 tells us that. So if you look at the text of Acts 2, modern day, the countries that were gathered was modern day Iran, Iraq, Turkey, and Italy. And they're speaking the tongues of the various and sundry nations that had gathered. So the beginning of the church was the end of racism. I don't know how to end more powerfully than that. So friends, let's fight for unity. Let's fight for this message of John, Paul, Jesus, and the Old Testament. And let's show that we all have the same worth, regardless of our skin color, the half shekel worth. We're all living stones with palms engraved on us. So we'll hold those palms from every tribe, nation, and tongue before the sea of glass and the throne and the rainbow. There's neither Jew nor Greek, Scythian nor barbarian, male nor female. And honestly, this message needs to get out to the world because it's become so divided and we need to show people apologetics for a new generation. And that now Christianity is the most racially, ethnically, culturally diverse, socioeconomically diverse belief system in the world. Praise God. Let's pray. Make us one. I just close with this prayer of John 17, 21. I pray that we would all be one in you. Just as Jesus is one with the Father, so Father, I pray that we would be one in you and take this apologetic and understand what the faith has done in bringing down racism once and for all. We're not there yet, but help us to continue to make progress. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.